go. But my suspicion is that we may actually start to figure out what is consciousness and what are these cells really doing?
That's right.
And how does this really work? And at that point, there's nothing to be afraid of because, you know, if you're like a professor, you're a researcher, you're a scientist, you're afraid that the creationists are going to show up and shut down your research.
Sure.
Like they really literally are afraid of that for good reason. Because the creationists think that evolution is a hoax. They're not talking about Barbara McClintock. They're not, right? They're not telling you how evolution works. But if you go to the other side and you come from the spiritual perspective, you're going, you know, I don't like it when people reduce the wonderful amazingness of biology to a big story about random accidents that you could never possibly prove if you even wanted to. Like, that doesn't serve science either. And frankly, it's not true. Like, it's just dreadfully awful science. When in fact, what's really going on is, you know, these cells are doing these amazing genetic engineering maneuvers, and we need to understand what's going on. That's we right. have to understand what's – we'll never solve cancer. We'll never solve diabetes. We'll never solve any of this stuff if we continue to think that it's all random.
Well, and I think you're right. People are afraid because they think it'll ruin their career. They think that they'll get chastised, and actually – the whole goal of this show is to harmonize those tough things. And even if it's money, even if the reason why some of these things are underreported is ultimately because of money, you know, we want to forgive people if that's the case. And we want to start to not just attack, and but also understand that it's not so easy. You can't just say, kumbaya, let's come together. There are a lot of interests involved. And we're going to help some people. We're going to see if we can help people right now, get some ideas. I want somebody to win. It's $3 million if it's patentable, I guess. Mm-hmm. So I want somebody to win that. So what I want to do right now, it goes right along with what you were saying, because there are people that are scientists who are willing to push that line. And one of them, actually a guy named Francis Crick. So Francis Crick, and Perry knows this, but a lot of people don't. I certainly, you know, I've heard about it about a year ago. Francis Crick, and our viewers can see this, he actually was the guy who was a Nobel Prize winner and the discoverer of the structure of the DNA molecule. Mm-hmm. And Perry, I want to get some of your thoughts on some of these things that we found, because this goes right along with what you were saying. And so Francis Crick, what he said, and we're looking right now at a book by Graham Hancock, who's sold millions and millions of books, who's very into peer-reviewed work and, you know, stuff that's sort of like not nonsense. And Francis Crick, from Graham Hancock's research, there's a quote in here that Crick, who discovered DNA, said that the odds against such instant life are beyond the astronomical, more unlikely than the assembly of a Boeing 707 by a hurricane in a junkyard. And if we go to another book by Don Nix, Patterns of Being, Collected Thoughts and the Nature of Reality, Francis Crick, who discovered DNA while under the influence of LSD, which is a whole another discussion, he was disturbed at the improbability of even a single fully assembled protein made up of a long string of amino acids emerging through the chance collision of molecules. And Crick said, it is far too complex to have arisen at one blow. It must have evolved from something simpler. However, there's no evidence that any such evolution took place on Earth before the spread of the first DNA-based bacteria about 3.9 billion years ago. But then, when he gets into the same quote about the Boeing 707, it says, Crick was an expert mathematician, and he estimated the odds at 1 followed by 260 zeros, that this all just happened by chance. And he said that it's such a remarkable mechanism that exists. And it goes on here, if we can get down to the second page, because this is so interesting. After wrestling with this question, Crick came up with the remarkable theory of panspermia, the idea that life forms, probably in the form of bacteria, must have been sent to Earth in spaceships by an alien civilization. In other words, life did not originate on Earth, but was seeded from another planet, possibly more layers to the onion. And another variation was put forward by Sir Fred Hoyle. Both Crick and Hoyle thought that DNA did not originate here and must have come together elsewhere before it went into action on Earth. Now, I want to go to another thing, and then I want to get Perry's thoughts. This is Natural World News, and our YouTube viewers can see this, naturalworldnews.com. Extraterrestrial expose, Vatican to reveal its best-kept alien secret soon. And we have a quote from Father Jose Gabriel Fuentes. And what he says, and he holds a master's degree in astronomy. And he's also, you know, he works with the Vatican. The discovery of the new planet Kepler. Let's see what this says here. This website's jumping around. Too many ads. Perry knows about these. The discovery of the new planet Kepler-452b revives the idea that contact, and why not, the encounter with extraterrestrial intelligent beings of an alien civilization could happen in the near future. He goes on to say that that doesn't mean there isn't Jesus, but he goes on to say, Perry, that it is highly possible, and we're talking about the Vatican, so I would love to hear your thoughts on those things. Just any thoughts that come to mind.
Well, so I don't really have any bias one way or the other about extraterrestrials. I'm certainly not somebody who's going to put down somebody who thinks that they're out there. I mean, sure. How much could we possibly, I mean, we know about, you know, we know a thimble
that's
of
right.
knowledge
that's
in a
right.
vast universe, right? So there's no justification in hubris that sneers at things. I take a more philosophical point of view, which is, well, if you're really trying to answer the question, it only kicks the can further down the road. You still end up with the question of where did the alien came from and all of that. And so I don't think the life came from elsewhere, from aliens. I don't think that is as helpful. Now, there is a whole field called astrobiology,
right,
which is concerned with, well, could life have developed elsewhere? And it's kind of about chemistry and all of that. And, you know, I'm a Christian, and I'm probably like the Vatican guy. Like, I don't really sure. think that changes Christianity one way or sure. the other. In fact, Mormons are actually fairly friendly. They seem to have thought about this harder than most of us have.
Right.
But I would say that I for scientifically peeling the onion, here's what I do think all of this means. I think the universe is consciousness first, matter second, not matter first and consciousness second. And I think that science has defaulted to bottom-up reductionism and rejected top-down. But in fact, consciousness is a top-down way of looking at things rather than bottom up. And I actually want to key into something you talked about at the very beginning of the podcast. You talked about Galileo figuring out, well, the Earth revolves around the sun, and then eventually like, well, actually that was a little premature too, right?
Mm-hmm.
And if you keep zooming out, well, where is the center of the universe? Like, does
That's
anybody
right.
even know? Is there a center? And then cosmologists will tell you that, well, it's actually this like four-dimensional manifold, and then you get into all this weird geometry and
right.
stuff. And so this actually brings up a great point. So I have a friend named Dennis Noble.
Okay.
And just to give you, Dennis organized the recent evolution conference at the Royal Society in London. He is a very eminent scientist in the UK. He's the researcher who figured out the cardiac rhythm, which made pacemakers possible. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And he's written a lot of papers on evolution, and a lot of his heart research gave him insight into evolution, where he realized the way the genes of the heart work, and he had to work with them because of heart rhythms and stuff. He figured out that the traditional Darwinian explanation of genes was completely wrong.
Right.
Okay.
Wow.
And he wrote a book that just came out recently. It's called Dance to the Tune of Life, Biological Relativity. And what he does in his book is really funny. You bring this up about Galileo and what's the center of the universe.
Sure.
Like, really uncanny, because in his book, he says, just like we don't even know if there is a center of the universe, he says, all of biology, whether you look at one cell or even a part of a cell or an organ or a whole organism or even the whole earth, it's systems within systems within systems within systems within systems. And there's no single place in any of it where you can go, this is the starting point, or this, you know, like, this is where it all begins.
Wow. So there's no center.
There's no center to biology. It's systems and feedback.
And we're
and
even
interactions and mutuality.
And it goes on and on. It traces on and on. And we're even showing right now on NASA.gov, Europa's ocean may have an Earth-like chemical balance. This is on NASA's website. Who knew that Europa, which is a moon of Jupiter, even had oceans? Another article on NASA.gov. NASA confirms evidence that liquid water flows on today's Mars. Now, this next one I love. Sirius documentary reveals DNA tests on Atta, the six-inch being that was verified as a real being by Dr. Gary Nolan at Stanford, one of the top geneticists in the world, a six-inch seven-year-old that lived within the past 100 years. It's a documentary, was one of the top documentaries on Netflix, and Sirius disclosure. And this, my opinion, you don't have to comment on this. This is no human. The article on Huffington Post, which was shared millions of times, but not enough. I didn't know this. It came out in 2013. The documentary, he doesn't want to say that it's not human, but he dances around it. And he says, we're putting the DNA code out there, but this is a real being that a Stanford geneticist says is 7 years old and is 6 inches tall that lived. They did x-rays, they did DNA samples. I mean, this is wild. And Perry, I want to get to a couple more things to support your research and to give people ideas on how they can actually maybe win this. I mean, we have here Dr. Luc Montagnier. I pronounced that wrong. He's a French guy, probably. DNA.
I know who that is.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So DNA in water spontaneously generates just almost exactly what you said regarding the replication example of the plants being next to each other. Two tubes. He did it with frequencies, a 7 hertz frequency, and it spontaneously generated in the test tube next to the original test tube. And this is from Hidden Origins with Michael Tellinger on Gaia.com. Another scientific study, DNA molecules can teleport. Nobel Prize winner claims. Actually, this is the same one. Yeah. This
Luc
is on Tech World. Another article from this one I really recommend. Russian biophysicist and molecular biologist. Я говорю по-русски плохо. I speak Russian terribly. Пётр Гераджавер. Which basically, in this article from wakeup-world.com, listen, this is more of a new age site, but these studies, scientists prove DNA can be reprogrammed by sounds and frequencies. And if you go through here, these guys wrote a book. These Russian scientists talks about hypercommunication. I mean, you know, the book is called Networked Intelligence. It goes right along with what you said. It is not even discussed And these guys are no dummies. I don't know about you, Perry. I've hired Russian programmers. They're very good. They're very good. They're some of the best. Another article by David Wilcock, which talks about on divinecosmos.com, who's a great researcher, fantastic proof of spontaneous DNA manifestation by a great doctor that is, we're going to go down here, Pacheco. Pacheco, he took DNA, he sterilized a test tube, he put raw materials in the test tube, and DNA started forming and little life. Dr. Ignacio Pacheco, I'm butchering that name, but the point here is that this is, there's so much to this. And the last thing, Perry, and this, and I want to get your, just a brief comment on all those, and I know we're going to go, but here's a study, express.co.uk, mainstream. There is life after death. Scientists reveal shock findings from groundbreaking study. Life after death has been confirmed by scientists who have discovered consciousness continues even once a person has died. Over 2,000 people, British University of Southampton, shows people still experience awareness for up to 3 minutes after they had been pronounced dead. The doctor, the lead researcher, Dr. Sam Parnia, contrary to perception, this is what he says, contrary to perception, death is not a specific moment, but a potentially reversible process that occurs after severe illness. He goes on to say, he goes on to talk, they studied 2,060 patients. He continued, this suggests more people may have mental activity initially, but then lose their memories after recovery, either due to the effects of brain injury or sedative drugs on memory recall, but that's not the most important quote in this. The most important quote, I'm so excited about this. This is significant since it has often been assumed that experience in relation to death are likely hallucinations or illusions occurring either before the heart stops or after the heart had been successfully restarted, but not an experience corresponding with real events when the heart isn't beating. In this case, consciousness and awareness appeared to occur during a 3-minute period when there was no heartbeat. This is paradoxical since the brain typically ceases functioning within 20 to 30 seconds of the heart stopping and doesn't resume again until the heart has been restarted. Furthermore, the detailed recollections of visual awareness in this case were consistent with verified events. And basically it's that, and we're going to go back to you, Perry. I mean, these things are so unbelievably amazing. To me, there is scientific evidence, just like all the beautiful things in your book at cosmicfingerprints.com. I bought it on Amazon and I downloaded the first 3 chapters for free. But there are so many underreported things that you get to in your book, Perry. And then we just touched on really quickly, and we'll get into it in the future. Listen, we're just getting started on this show. Believe the sound isn't perfect. The video is not perfect. But this is our goal. You're a brave man. You're a hero, Perry, because you're willing to bring up some of these underreported things and not demonize people who have failed to maybe talk about this, think their reputation's on the line. There are MIT professors on ancient aliens. There are people talking about this now, and you're a great guy. You're one of them. You're a hero. And I think, honestly, there's a bit of a flat earth society, and I don't think you're in it. I don't think you're in the flat earth society when it comes to this topic. So tell me your thoughts, and then we'll wrap it up, Perry.
Well, you know, you covered like this wide spectrum of things, and here's what you'll, when you go down these little rabbit trails.
Sure.
Here's my experience. Here's what you find. My experience is 80% of it not very useful, not very credible.
Sure.
You know, fringy, sure, whatever. However, 20% or maybe 10 or maybe 5, but you know, there's a slice of it that, when you chase it down, it's pretty hard to refute, you know, there's all kinds of near-death experiences, out-of-body experience where like the guy's pronounced dead on the operating table and he can tell you there's a blue shoe on the gutter at the top of the hospital on the roof you know, and they go up there and yeah, there's a blue That's shoe right. up there. And, you know,
the CIA did remote viewing, is the CIA declassified programs.
Right. And there's a whole book called The Conscious Universe that documents it all. There's a lot of this stuff. Here's what I want to say about
sure.
it.
Sure.
There's so when you put all this out there. So, yes, I totally get it's fringy and I don't know how much of it right. is correct. I like so, you know, not really trying to necessarily defend specific
That's
things.
That's right.
But. The skeptic will always come back and they'll make fun of it and they'll go, well, that's been disproven. That's usually my experience is the skeptic is stuck in the 19th century.
Right.
I mean, it really. And yeah, the old school Darwinists are stuck in the 1950s. And if you And this is just the nature of science is. Think I want you to really hear me out here.
Okay.
Science is mostly funded by the National Science Foundation and the National Institute of Health in a handful of government agencies. Okay. It's a government bureaucracy. Think post office. Now,
right.
the post office is not a conspiracy, but That's it is right. not the most competent thing you've ever seen in your life by any means. Okay. I know lots of scientists. they live and die by their funding.
That's
and
right.
There's a ton of political correctness and there's a ton of like their employees. They work for big institutions. They're non-entrepreneurs. They're not in a position to take risks. And one slip and their whole career is over. This is the truth about science. So there are certain taboos. So like things like remote viewing and telekinesis and stuff like that. This has been documented for 100 years.
That's right.
It just doesn't happen to be acceptable in the mainstream academy. But
government has documented
books about just that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Margins of Reality by John and Dunn. That book is so boring, nobody could have possibly made it up.
You could. Okay. You're very smart.
But no, the studies are there and they comport with my experience. And so the universe is way stranger than you know or you can even imagine.
That's
and
right.
There's a difference. There's a huge difference between reality and the model of reality that happens to be in your brain right now. They are not the same. So there's the should be world and there's the is world. And, you know, hopefully I can get people a little closer to the is world and know that the is world is much more amazing
that's
than
right.
the version that's been in your head.
Yes, I really, really appreciate that because I think that what you've done with this book, Perry, is you've started to have a mature discussion that's not demonizing, as I mentioned earlier, either party. You're looking at things. Basically, what I see happening in the world right now is that very intelligent people, including, again, Dr. Gary Nolan, just to be in that documentary with the 7-year-old 6-inch being, which is Sirius Disclosure, SIRIUS, on Netflix with Dr. Stephen Greer, who ran an emergency room for 11 years and briefed the CIA director under Bill Clinton. It's not like a dummy. It's not like fringe. But some of these things are, and we know that. Some of this is, you know, it's not perfect, but I think what you're saying is maybe neither is creationism and neither is evolution. There's a middle ground. You're very courageous, and actually, I think this book, everybody should buy it at cosmicfingerprints.com because it's not for money. It's because the message is we want to be accepting of everybody who just, even if they're on the fringes right now, the far right creationists, the far left evolutionists, it's because they're afraid. They're afraid to look maybe at themselves. We're afraid. I know I'm afraid about some things, but Perry has given us a tool to start just looking at the underreported studies and not demonizing, you know, the post office and even the scientific foundation you mentioned as part of the government, but to actually look at things and say, hey, they've done the best they can. Maybe they have other interests where they can't disclose right. certain things. But you know what? Let's try to harmonize. Let's try to come together. Let's look at these studies. And the truth of the matter is, I think it's all going to come out eventually anyway. And it doesn't hurt. You're not a bad person or you're not stupid for looking at it. In fact, it could be the opposite. And when you start to look at these things, you may start to find your true purpose in the universe, Perry. And I think that's what you really wanted to leave people with, isn't it?
That's right. That's right. Fear no important question. Well, ignore no verifiable fact.
Wow. That last sentence is very powerful. And actually, I threw a million things at people to get them. We're going to go into that in future episodes. Maybe we can have Perry back in the future. But those, hey, I want you guys to win that $3 million. I threw like a million things out. My voice was jumpy. I was going crazy because I wanted to get to all of them because they're so amazing. Just some of that, maybe 20% is true. And Perry wrote another book, The 80-20, I think it's Marketing Principles. I would buy all of Perry's books at Amazon. But Perry Marshall, it's been a great honor to have you on the show. Thank you for joining us on Believe, and have a great day.